The gag reflex can be done not only by touching the posterior pharyngeal wall, but anything at the oropharynx level. It could be even touching the uvula, the palate. Some books will call it as the palatal reflex, but it is a component of the gag reflex only. As we notice, this is one of the histology question, which is asking us about the microscopic picture of tongue and asking us which type of papilla is this. Now, let us look at some details and then we can come back towards the options, whether it is circumvallate papilla, fungiform, filiform, or foliate papilla. As is observed, tongue is lined by the epithelium, stratified squamous epithelium, and the same epithelium will be moving on to the papilla as well. Papilla is basically a mucosal elevation having a core of connective tissue and lined by this particular epithelium, mostly for the purpose of having these pale areas, that is the taste buds. So papilla will have taste buds to carry the taste sensation by the gustatory cells located in the taste buds. Let us have some more details now. And what we find here is four types of tongue papilla. Papilla are mostly present on the dorsum of the tongue as compared with the undersurface or ventral surface. So mostly they are on the upper or dorsal surface. And more so in front of this sulcus terminalis, which is an embryological V-shaped line separating the anterior two-thirds of tongue from the posterior one-third of tongue, the sulcus terminalis. So most of the papilla are in front of that sulcus. Now you can start with one which is filiform papilla. As the name is suggesting, filiform means pointed, as compared with fungiform papilla, which will be fungus or mushroom shaped. We'll be zooming these to have more details. Here we are just enumerating them. Then comes one leaf-shaped foliate papilla. The names are explaining the feature of papilla itself. And then largest of all in front of the sulcus terminalis, around 8 to 12 circumvallate papilla. They are the largest of all and can have a diameter of about 1 to 2 millimeter. And they are having the largest number of taste buds at the sides, as many as 250 taste buds per circumvallate papilla. So one papilla can have about 250 taste buds, having the taste cells or gustatory cells with some nerve fibers carrying the taste sensation. Like we know, in front of sulcus terminalis, the circumvallate papilla, the taste will be carried by embryologically glossopharyngeal nerve. Otherwise, anterior two-thirds of tongue, the taste sensation will be carried by cauda tympani nerve. Now be careful. Taste buds are mostly on circumvallate papilla and the least number, or they are actually absent from the filiform papilla. Filiform papilla, they are quite numerous and they are white in color. And why they are white in color? Because they are heavily keratinized and they have no taste buds. They basically create friction between the tongue and the food and help in movement of the food particles. As compared with the interspersed fungiform papilla, the fungiform papilla and filiform papilla are interspersed with each other, and these fungiform or mushroom shaped papilla are red in appearance. Now, why they are appearing red? Because their connective tissue core is highly vascularized, hence giving the red color. They do have some taste buds, but more taste buds are present in foliate and circumvallate papilla. Now be careful, the foliate papilla are seen only in small age children. They are rudimentary in the adults, so we do not focus more upon foliate papilla. Plus, they have a typical location. They are present here on the sides of the tongue, like some ridges. So these ridges shape or leaf shape foliate papilla are not to be discussed in detail because they are rudimentary. Our more focus should remain upon circumvallate papilla. Circum means circular, vallate means wall. If you look at the structure of the circumvallate papilla, this is the papilla itself having a core of connective tissue covered by the tongue epithelium. But surrounding that is a circular pit. As you notice here, we have magnified the circumvallate papilla here. Around that is a circular pit. And in the pit, you can see some saliva. This pit will come as dipping down, as you can see here. And it's like a trench around the papilla. So, in fact, it is circular in nature. But since it is a cut section, it is coming like a trench in this view. And on the side, you see some mucosal folds working like a wall. So, first you have the papilla. Around that, there is a pit. And still around that is a wall, which you can show here. Some mucosal elevation, which is guarding the papilla and the pit here. So basically, we have got the papilla, surrounding that is the pit, and surrounding that is the wall, which is also called as the vellate. So wall or vellate. And since it is circular, that is why the name is circumvallate papilla, a papilla with circular wall. And since we have taken a cut section of that, this vellate or the wall is appearing here. So this is the wall on either side. The wall, the pit, and the papilla itself. Now let us look at the detailed histological picture. So as we suggested, there are four type of tongue papilla we are supposed to focus upon, and they are mostly present on the dorsum of the tongue in front of this sulcus terminalis. We were talking about circumvallate papilla with the circular wall covering the pit, which is covering the papilla itself. Talking about its histology, you can focus upon the diagram here. Let me zoom the area a little bit. And as we notice, this is the circumvallate papilla, a projection of mucosa having a core of connective tissue with the epithelium, which is typically stratified squamous epithelium. But this papilla, the surface is not covered by much of keratin. So less of keratin is present on circumvallate papilla. And we were talking about this papilla surrounded by a circular pit, which you can see here. This is the pit on either side. And this pit itself will be surrounded by a circular wall, the mucosal fold, which we were calling as the vellate, can be seen here on one side and the other side as well. Now we will notice that the saliva was moving into these pits and will have some food particles where the taste can be detected. And as you notice, the circumvallate papilla on the sides have some pale areas. These pale areas are the taste buds. They will be having some taste cells or gustatory cells sending the taste into the axons, which will then constitute the nerve. And there can be as many as 250 taste buds in one single circumvallate papilla on the sides. Plus you notice there are some serous glands at the base of circumvallate papilla, the von Ebner's gland, and these glands, which are called as the von Ebner's gland, they are pouring some serous secretions into the base of this pit, which we are calling as the trench. And notice one more thing, this trench is kind of narrowing down so that if you follow the shape of the papilla, the base is narrow as compared with the apex. So as you can notice, the trench or the pit is narrowing down. The base is narrow as compared with the apex, which is wider. This will help us to differentiate it with the other type of papilla, which is foliate papilla. Foliate means leaf shaped. And as we zoom out, you will notice, we already have mentioned that the foliate papilla are on the sides of the tongue, ridge shape in gross appearance and leaf shape in microscopic appearance. We might confuse the foliate with the vellate because they can also appear to show the pits, which are actually the ridges. So how will you differentiate between the foliate papilla and the circumvallate papilla? As you can see the magnified picture here, let us zoom it and compare the two, the foliate with the circumvallate papilla. As we mentioned, these papilla are basically mucosal folds with some connective tissue at the core lined by the epithelium, stratified squamous epithelium. Again, it is non-keratinized. In fact, the keratinized epithelium is absent from the circumvallate papilla, foliate papilla, even the fungiform papilla. It is actually present on the filiform papilla. Anyhow, what about the pits which you were seeing and comparing between the circumvallate papilla and and the foliate papilla. Actually, foliate papilla, as you notice here, they are present in rows, one after the other. As we have seen on the side of the tongue, there are ridges and there are some dips. So between the series of the foliate papilla, you'll have these dips. They will appear like the trenches which we see in case of the circumvallate papilla. But then here it was circular and here they are longitudinal. Plus one more thing, as we noticed in circumvallate papilla, the trench is coming this way, so the base is narrow and the apex is wider, as you can notice here. But that is not so in case of foliate papilla. The dips are straight so that there is no difference between the base and the apex of the papilla, the foliate papilla. And you can notice one more thing, even the foliate papilla will have taste buds, but the number of taste buds, which are some pale areas appearing on the sides, they are very few as compared with the circumvallate papilla. Very high in number, as high as 250 in counting per circumvallate papilla. Plus, circumvallate papilla is seen single, whereas the foliate papilla are seen in a series. And even if you compare the size, the largest of all papilla are circumvallate papilla, though in this particular diagram, we have zoomed out of the picture here just to have a comparative view, which you can make out by the thickness of the epithelium. As you notice here, this is a zoomed picture as compared with this one. So largest of all the four papilla will be the circumvallate papilla. I told you 1 to 2 millimeter in diameter, which is quite huge. Now coming to the fungiform and filiform papilla, as the names are suggesting, filiform means pointed structure. As you can notice here, these pointed structures, the filiform papilla are highly keratinized mucosal folds, and that is why they appear white in color on the tongue. And their chief purpose is to provide friction between food and the tongue for movement of food particles. Whereas if you look at the fungiform papilla, which is mushroom-shaped papilla, they will have highly vascular connective tissue core. So the shape is like a mushroom, and you can notice it has very little of keratin over the epithelium. And this is the vascular core the arrows are showing, which is highly vascular. That is why they are appearing red dots on the dorsum of the tongue. Now, once we are through with the thorough details, we can go back to our question. So this was our question. They were asking the type of tongue papilla in the microscopic picture. The options were 4 type of papilla: the circumvallate, fungiform, filiform, or foliate. And before we comment upon the answer, we have put the other 2 types for quick comparison here. I have not put the foliate because, as we said, foliate, which are like ridges on the side of the tongue, are rudimentary, so not discussed very often. Now, as you can notice, this is one pointed structure, another pointed structure, and having lot of keratin over that, which you can show here. This is a lot of keratin on the filiform papilla. And you'll find there are some regions, intermittent regions, where the squamous epithelium do not have keratin. So non-keratinized epithelium, then keratinized epithelium, non-keratinized, again keratinized epithelium. These pointer structures are multiple in number, white in color, filiform papilla, and interspersed among them are the fungiform papilla or the mushroom-shaped papilla. These mushroom-shaped papilla, again the keratin is missing. And you will notice this is the mucosal epithelium covering a connective tissue core, which in case of fungiform papilla will be highly vascular, hence the red color appearing on the dorsum of the tongue. So this is the fungiform papilla. And as you compare them with the circumvallate papilla, first of all, it is larger in size, and circum means circular, vallate means wall. This is the circular wall. The vallate you can see on one side and the other side as well. This vallate or the wall is covering the pit, the trench, which is itself circular in fashion. And at the base of the trench, we find the von Ebner's glands are giving secretions, the serous secretions, into the pit, which itself will be actually filled with saliva. In the saliva, you need to detect the taste, and taste can be detected by the taste buds, which are appearing like these pale areas, about 250 in number. And these taste buds, what they have is the gustatory cell. If you magnify the taste bud, it'll appear like this. There'll be a pore on the outer side to receive the saliva. And then we have the gustatory cells, the taste cells, interspersed between some supporting cells and stem cells. And these gustatory cells, they'll be receiving the axons, which will then carry the impulses of the taste sensation as a nerve. So it's a magnified picture, basically. And as you can notice, the trench is coming in such a way that the base of the papilla is narrow as compared with the apex. So this is a circumvallate papilla. That is a fungiform papilla. And this is a filiform papilla. The foliate papilla, first of all, they will be in a series and separated by some pits. The straight pits, they are not converging pits. And the taste buds on foliate papilla will be few in number. Moreover, they are rudimentary. So we got our answer. The type of papilla which we are looking at is none other than circumvallate papilla. Choice number A should be our answer. So let us keep this answer here as we have deduced. And one more thing you can remember, comparing the circumvallate with the fungiform papilla, the taste buds in circumvallate papilla are in huge number. As compared with the fungiform, you can notice for yourself, the number of taste buds are very few. And if it comes to the filiform papilla, they do not have any taste buds at all. So we need to keep our answer just by looking at the number of taste buds as well. Choice number A, circumvallate papilla. This patient is having some problem with the vision and he is complaining of diminishing vision on the right halves of both the eyes. Now, when you say right half of both the eyes, that means the right eye peripheral vision is gone and left eye the nasal vision is gone. Or you can say temporal hemifield of vision is lost on the right eye and nasal hemifield of left eye is lost. That is why right half of each eye is blind. It is also called as right-sided homonymous hemianopia and it can happen in post-chiasmal lesions. Let us look at some details before we could commit our answer here. Whether it is the optic nerve level, optic chiasma, or the optic tract, or in the visual cortex itself. Now, in this diagram, we are looking from the superior view of the brain. The patient is lying in such a way, the head is towards our side and feet are away from us. As we look from the superior view, we can mention this will be the right eye and this is superior view of the left eye. The nose is shown anterior. Now, this is the normal binocular vision of Eiffel Tower. And we want to mention that for this particular patient, the right half of each eye is blind. As you can notice here, this part of the vision is gone. On the right eye means right temporal vision or right peripheral vision is lost, whereas on the left side, the nasal vision has been compromised, as you can notice here. It can be mentioned right half of each eye is blind, or it is right homonymous hemianopia. As I suggested, it can happen in post-chiasmal lesions. Now, to discuss that, let us look at the normal pathway and then some of the lesions. So as we can notice, this is the superior view of the right eye, and on the other side, this is superior view of the left eye. We are taking the same example from here. Then we can mention the peripheral vision or temporal vision of the right eye, as we mention here, is received by the nasal retina. And then it'll cross the midline in optic chiasma to reach the opposite side, occipital visual cortex. The same happens for the left eye as well. You can mention the temporal vision or the peripheral vision of the left eye is received by the nasal retina and then it will be crossing the midline of the body in optic chiasma to reach the contralateral occipital visual cortex. That means the peripheral vision crossing the optic chiasma reaches the opposite occipital visual cortex, which you can mention here as well. The temporal field or the peripheral visual field of the left eye is received by the nasal retina, as you can see here, and then it has to cross in the optic chiasma. As you follow it, crossing the optic chiasma, it will reach the right-sided optic tract and then the lateral geniculate body. And from the right geniculate body, it'll go go to right occipital visual cortex via the geniculocalcline tract or optic radiation. So it has reached the occipital cortex now. The left peripheral vision goes to the right-sided occipital cortex. As we have mentioned here, similarly, you can talk about the right-sided peripheral field coming to left visual cortex. It'll first use the optic nerve, then there is optic chiasma, then optic tract, the lateral geniculate body, optic radiation, and occipital visual cortex. Let us mention it here. The right eye temporal vision or peripheral vision is received by the nasal retina, carried by the optic nerve, and then reaches the optic chiasma, crossing to the opposite side of the body. Then it uses the optic tract to reach the left-sided geniculate body, and then left-sided optic radiation to reach the left occipital visual cortex. Now, we have talked about the crossing of the peripheral visual fibers. If there is a midline tumor, pituitary tumor, or if there is anterior communicating artery aneurysm, it can compromise the optic chiasma, resulting in bitemporal hemianopia. As you can see here, the right-sided temporal vision is compromised, whereas left-sided temporal vision is also compromised. This is called as a lesion at the optic chiasma or bitemporal hemianopia. The temporal field is gone and it is the tunnel vision. So as we proceed further, let us talk about the inner vision or nasal vision as well. So let us start with the superior view of the right eye, and the nasal vision of the right eye is received by the temporal retina, and then it will continue ipsilaterally towards the occipital cortex. So nasal field fibers go ipsilaterally. As you can mention in this diagram also, superior view of the right eye, the nasal vision is being received by the temporal retina, and from the temporal retina it will be carried by the ganglion cell axons, which is the optic nerve, and the optic nerve will take it to the optic chiasma, but without crossing it will continue in the optic tract, reaching the lateral geniculate body. On the same side, the right geniculate body will send it to the right occipital visual cortex. So this is running ipsilaterally. You can mention the same for the left eye as well. So left eye, the nasal vision being received by temporal retina and running ipsilaterally going to the same sided occipital visual cortex. The same you can show in the schematic diagram also. The nasal vision of the left eye is being received by temporal retina, then runs in the optic nerve, optic chiasma, without crossing, continuing the optic tract, reaching lateral geniculate body, and then the optic radiation to the ipsilateral occipital visual cortex. So once we are comfortable with this information, we can mention lesion number A. The left optic nerve has been compromised. Now, if the left optic nerve is compromised, then the left eye becomes blind. As you can notice, lesion number A, the left eye has become blind. No vision at all. Now, what about lesion number B, where the peripheral vision was compromise, we have already mentioned, by temporal hemianopia. Peripheral vision is lost, there is a tunnel vision. Now, when it comes to post-chiasmal lesion, for example, lesion number C, left optic tract is compromised. There will be contralateral homonymous hemianopia, means the lesion is on the left side, but the problem will be on the right side. Right half of each eye will become blind. Right homonymous hemianopia. As you can notice, the nasal vision of the left eye is compromised. Right half of the visual field is compromised, whereas the peripheral vision of the right eye has been compromised. And that was actually our case. Left-sided optic tract injury results in loss of vision of the left nasal field and right temporal field, or right half of each eye is blind. That is what we have seen here. Right half of each eye is blind. Right homonymous hemianopia. That was our question. So the problem is with the left-sided optic tract. That is our answer. Now, this picture can be similar if we have the lesion D, which we can assume a block in the posterior cerebral artery and occipital visual cortex is compromised. It will also present with contralateral homonymous hemianopia. So, as you can mention, the right half of each eye is blind again. Then what is the difference between the lesion D, a block in the posterior cerebral artery, and the lesion lesion C, which is injury to the optic tract. There is macular sparing in block of posterior cerebral artery. As you will notice, central vision is still working. And if the central vision is still working, we call it as contralateral homonymous hemianopia with macular sparing. And the macular sparing or central vision sparing is because the representation of the macula in the retina on the occipital visual cortex, that part of brain has collateral supply from middle cerebral artery also. Maybe posterior cerebral artery is compromised, but middle cerebral artery is still working. So macular area still working. That is why central vision is still working. Macular sparing in a block of posterior cerebral artery. But that was not mentioned in our question. Let's go back to our question. As we see, it is a 30-year-old patient who is complaining of loss of vision on the right half of each eye, right homonymous hemianopia. So is there a mention of macular sparing here? No. So this cannot be a lesion of occipital visual cortex, though it is post-chiasmal lesion. Then what is the answer? See, if optic nerve is compromised, then the same-sided eye will become blind. May it be peripheral vision or nasal vision cannot be the answer. If it is optic chiasma, you'll have bitemporal hemianopia, tunnel vision. That is not the presentation. So that is why our answer should be left-sided optic tract, and we cannot answer it as the right occipital lobe. Any half. First of all, it'll be contralateral homonymous hemianopia. And second, where is the mention of macular sparing? It's not there. So we'll keep our answer as choice number C, a lesion in the left optic tract leading to contralateral homonymous hemianopia. In the present patient, we find there is a history of vision loss, and on investigation, there has been found one artery, the aneurysm, compressing the optic chiasma level. Now, we know if optic chiasma is compromised, there will be a tunnel vision or bitemporal hemianopia. Peripheral vision of each eye will be lost, since the peripheral vision crosses in the optic chiasma to reach the contralateral occipital visual cortex. If there is a lesion in the optic chiasma, the peripheral vision is compromised. But anyhow, which of the following artery is having that aneurysm? This is what we need to find out. Choices given are anterior choroidal artery, anterior communicating artery, anterior cerebral artery, and middle cerebral artery also. The circle of Willis has to be discussed before we mark our answer here. So we have to look from the inferior view of the brain or base of the brain. In the interpeduncular fossa, we have the circle of Willis contributed by 9 arteries. Though the initial contribution is by 2 major arteries, the internal carotid artery anteriorly and vertebral artery posteriorly. So what are the details? As you will notice, the internal carotid arteries are shown on both sides, which you can mark here as well, the internal carotid arteries. And then these internal carotid arteries are giving 2 major branches. One of that is the middle cerebral artery going laterally. This is seen from the inferior view, so left middle cerebral artery, and this is the right-sided middle cerebral artery. Since we are looking from the inferior view, you can mention right-sided middle cerebral artery coming from the internal carotid artery, and then you can also talk about the left-sided middle cerebral artery, which is not so clear here in this particular diagram. Now the internal carotid will give anterior cerebral artery as well to the anterior side of cerebrum. As evident here, the right-sided anterior cerebral artery being given here, you can mark it on the right side as well as the left side anterior cerebral artery. Now connecting the two is one anterior communicating artery. So we can mark the anterior communicating artery here. Actually, it is the aneurysm of anterior communicating artery which can compress the optic chiasma. You can see the optic chiasma here. In the vicinity of that, you can show anterior communicating artery. Actually, any aneurysm in the anterior communicating artery can compress the optic chiasma, leading to the tunnel vision or bitemporal hemianopia. You can mark the same here as well. As you mentioned, internal carotid artery has given anterior cerebral artery on the left side as shown here and the same on the undersurface of the brain, the right-sided anterior cerebral artery. And connecting the two is the anterior communicating artery. It is this anterior communicating artery connecting the anterior cerebral artery, which can compress the optic chiasma, as we have mentioned here as well. Now, let us look at the vertebrobasilar system contributing to circle of Willis. So there are two vertebral arteries uniting at the pontomedullary junction of the brainstem and then contributing to the basilar artery running at the base of the pons. We call it as vertebrobasilar system. And from there, you'll have the posterior cerebral artery on each side. So this is the right-sided posterior cerebral artery, and we have got the left-sided posterior cerebral artery here. And actually, it will be receiving the communication from the anterior circulation now, called as the posterior communicating artery, branch of internal carotid artery. So let us show that here as well. First, we have got the two vertebral arteries, and they are joining to form the basilar artery as observed here, and then basilar artery bifurcating into two branches, namely the right-sided posterior cerebral and left-sided as well. So this is the right-sided posterior cerebral artery and the left-sided posterior cerebral artery as shown here. And then you can mention the communication of the posterior circulation with the anterior circulation. Actually, internal carotid artery gives the posterior communicating artery, which joins the posterior cerebral artery. The purpose of such a communication is collateral circulation. In case one of the system, say internal carotid artery system, is compromised, still the territory can be supplied by the posterior system, vertebrobasilar system, or vice versa. So this is the left posterior communicating artery. This is the right posterior communicating artery, making the circle of Willis. You can show them here as well. This is the left-sided internal carotid artery giving the posterior communicating artery to join the posterior cerebral artery on the left side and on the right side as well. Now, what are the 9 arteries contributing to the circle of Willis? You can count them as 2 posterior cerebral arteries, the 2 posterior communicating arteries, the 2 internal carotid arteries, the 2 anterior cerebral arteries, and 1 anterior communicating artery. And that is where we have the aneurysm. Let us look at one more diagram to discuss it compressing the optic chiasma level. We have to magnify this diagram now. And again, we are looking at the base of the brain, inferior view of the brain. First, let us mark the optic nerve, optic chiasma, optic tract here. This is going to be the left-sided optic nerve, and coming to the optic chiasma, and then this is the left-sided optic tract. Similarly, this is the right-sided optic nerve coming to optic chiasma, and then we have got the right-sided optic tract. So this is the optic chiasma level. As it is seen, the pituitary gland is very near to it in the midline. And if there is a pituitary adenoma, it can compress the optic chiasma, leading to bitemporal hemianopia. Peripheral vision will be compromised, tunnel vision. Similarly, the optic chiasma can be compromised by this artery, that is anterior communicating artery. Let us put the details of circle of Willis in this diagram first. We are starting with internal carotid artery. We can mention left-sided internal carotid artery here and the right-sided internal carotid artery here, which is giving us a branch called as the middle cerebral artery and also the anterior cerebral artery going anteriorly. Now you can mention the same detail for the undersurface of brain left side as well, the middle cerebral artery and then the anterior cerebral artery going anteriorly. And connecting the two, we have got anterior communicating artery, and it is the anterior communicating artery which can have aneurysm compressing the optic chiasma. Though remember, the anterior communicating artery aneurysm can compress the optic nerve also, but here it was compressing the optic chiasma, leading to bitemporal hemianopia. Now let us complete this diagram by drawing the vertebrobasilar system as well. As you notice, the two vertebral arteries would have formed the basilar artery running at the base of the pons here and then bifurcating into two branches, which are right-sided posterior cerebral artery and left-sided posterior cerebral artery. They are the one in the posterior circulation which are going to receive communication from the anterior circulation. So that is a branch of internal carotid artery named posterior communicating artery. So this is the internal carotid artery giving posterior communicating artery, which is anastomosing with posterior cerebral artery on the left side and right side as well. What you notice here is the oculomotor nerve as well, coming from the midbrain on the right side and oculomotor nerve on the left side. Anyhow, what are the nine arteries contributing to circle of Willis? There are two posterior cerebral arteries, there are two posterior communicating arteries, the two internal carotid arteries, the two anterior cerebral arteries, and one anterior communicating artery. Remember, aneurysms are more common on anterior communicating artery as compared with the posterior communicating artery. And then we can go back to our question. The problem was that of anterior communicating artery. This is a patient with history of vision loss due to some compression of the optic chiasma. Some artery aneurysm is involved, and that aneurysm is basically upon the anterior communicating artery. So choice number B should be our answer as such. A case has been brought to the emergency. It is basically a mother who has brought the child who is having difficulty in swallowing, and it's been there for past few hours. There is also a history of this child playing unsupervised, and now one x-ray has been taken. The examiner wants us to identify the location of a foreign body as seen here. Appears to be a coin, and one thing we have to understand, if this coin was actually in the respiratory tube like trachea, then the baby will be having difficulty in breathing and it'll be more acute presentation. So as we understand, it is difficulty in swallowing, and for past few hours it goes more in favor of the gut tube or the esophagus. The x-ray shown here is the AP view, anterior posterior, and one lateral view. Let us gather some detail before we can mark our answer in this particular question. Now we are looking from the lateral view and want to discuss the air passing respiratory tube and the food passing in the gut tube. The respiratory tube is more anterior and gut tube is placed more posterior. This is a dissected specimen, sagittal section, and this is the x-ray we were talking about. The coin is seen here. We want to find out which tube it is, gut tube or respiratory tube. Let us look at some skeletal landmark as well as the laryngeal landmarks here. We need to discuss the mandible bone in the side view and also the hyoid bone. Then we can talk about the cartilages, which will not appear on the x-ray but can be shown here. First, let us mark the mandible bone here, and then we can also talk about the hyoid bone in a sagittal section. So this is the hyoid bone shown in the dissected specimen. Then we can talk about the larynx cartilages. This is the lid over the larynx or the epiglottis having elastic cartilage. And most of the cartilages in the larynx are actually hyaline cartilage. For example, the largest cartilage is the thyroid cartilage, shown here anteriorly. Whereas you can see the ring-shaped cartilage or cricoid cartilage, the ring cricoid cartilage shown anteriorly as well as posteriorly. Posterior lamina is larger for the cricoid cartilage as compared with the anterior aspect. We also understand at the lower border of the cricoid cartilage, which is at the vertebra cervical C6, is the termination of larynx, further continuing as the trachea, and it is the same level where the pharynx will end and continue as the esophagus. So here is the trachea, lumen of trachea, below the C6 vertebra, and posteriorly at the same level begins the esophagus. Prior to that, it was the pharynx. Now pharynx itself has three components. If
it is behind the larynx, it is called laryngopharynx. If it is behind the oral cavity, oropharynx. And if it is behind the nasal cavity, the nasopharynx. So this is the nasal cavity. As you can see, nasal vestibule showing some hair. The air will come here. This is the inferior turbinate in the lateral wall of nasal cavity. The middle turbinate is also evident. And behind the nasal cavity, this is the nasopharynx. You can also see the opening of Eustachian tube in the nasopharynx behind the inferior turbinate. Now, as we are marking the nasopharynx here behind the nasal cavity, you can also talk about the oropharynx behind the oral cavity. In the oral cavity, you can see this is the tongue, and here is the hard palate, and this is the soft palate. So, below the level of soft palate, which is shown here, and above the level of epiglottis, shown here, is the oropharynx. And let us mark it here. Now, below the oropharynx will be the laryngopharynx. As larynx is anterior, pharynx is posterior, this is going to be the laryngopharynx. And once it reaches the lower border of the cricoid cartilage, it will then continue as the esophagus. Now, the thing is, where is this foreign body or the coin lying? It is actually in the esophagus. As we were discussing, the baby is having delayed arrival at the emergency room and difficulty swallowing. It goes more in favor of the gut tube or esophagus. Now, if this is the esophagus, in front of that, an x-ray will show air shadow, and that air shadow belongs to trachea. So as you can make out, the trachea is here as we are marking in the x-ray, and just behind that is the esophagus. So coin was actually in the esophagus, and above that, this entire region is going to be the pharynx, the gut tube basically, and in front of the pharynx, we can mention it is going to be the larynx in this region. And you can see the same features of the larynx in this dissector diagram. Actually, it is showing the laryngeal vestibule here, the false vocal cord, true vocal cords. This all is the larynx region. This is the lid over the larynx to close the larynx. The glottis being covered by epiglottis. So that whenever we are having some food, that food enters through the space between lips, upper lip, lower lip, goes on to the tongue, and is lying below the hard palate. This is the hard palate, basically the maxilla bone, and then the food has to come passing on the dorsum of the tongue towards the oropharynx. This food is not supposed to go towards the nasopharynx. From the oropharynx, it has to go towards the laryngopharynx, as we can follow it here. And that was how the coin has entered into the esophagus here. And it was actually the epiglottis which will close the glottis and will not allow the coin to enter into the larynx or trachea. But sometime it can happen. Foreign bodies can be seen in the trachea also, but then it will be acute presentation, difficulty in breathing. The child will be immediately noticed by the mother and brought to the emergency room, which was not the case. So this is our patient, a 9-year-old male baby brought to emergency. The baby was having unsupervised play, has swallowed something. We want to locate the foreign body by taking one x-ray. And as we can understand, the coin shown here is actually in the esophagus, because we can see the trachea in an x-ray marked by dark shadow is right in front of that. So this is the trachea. So this is the tracheal shadow. One other thing is, be careful. When you're looking from the front view, you are finding the coin in entirety. And this kind of presentation is usually when the coin is in the esophagus, because the lumen of the esophagus is like that. Coin can fit well this way. But be careful, if it was in the trachea, it would have passed through the larynx. And larynx has vocal cord arranged in anterior-posterior direction in a sagittal plane, opens like this for breathing, closes, opens. So since the orientation of vocal cord is anterior-posterior, if a coin goes inside, it will align mostly in anterior-posterior direction. Means you cannot have the full view of the coin if it was in the larynx passing into trachea. Though not necessary, this appearance, which is
usually in esophagus can also be in trachea. So one AP view can be confusing, but a lateral view is always diagnostic because, as we understood, if there is an air shadow in front of the coin, it is not in the respiratory tube. It is immediately in front of the vertebra, and just very close to vertebra anteriorly is the gut tube, the esophagus. Hence, our answer should remain esophagus. Presently, this patient is undergoing the submandibular gland excision, and the duct of the gland, which is the Wharton's duct, was being ligated. And while doing so, a nerve, which is close to this duct, has been compromised. So which is the most likely nerve to be compromised when we are working in the area of the duct? That is what the question is asking. And it is observed some of the nerves are given: inferior alveolar, lingual nerve, hypoglossal, marginal mandibular branch of facial. So before we choose our answer, let us gather some details, starting with the facial nerve itself. Because be careful, if we are operating on the submandibular gland, a gland under the mandible, it's a salivary gland, the most commonly damaged nerve is the marginal mandibular branch of facial nerve, which supplies the lower lip, and there can be drooping of the lower lip, the most common presentation of nerve injury in a case of submandibular gland surgeries. So should we take that as our answer? No, because usually the surgeon will be taking care of this branch. Let us see that how. So looking from the side view, we understand facial nerve will come out of the stylomastoid foramen, passes through the parotid gland and give 5 branches. And in those branches, there is one marginal mandibular branch as well. As you notice, facial nerve is giving the temporal, the zygomatic, the buccal, and then we can see marginal mandibular. As we said, it is going to supply the muscle of the lower lip. If damaged, there can be drooping of the lower lip. Though, even the cervical branch, if damaged, can lead to drooping of the lower lip. But mostly, the marginal mandibular nerve can be damaged. So what the surgeon is going to do to save this marginal mandibular branch of the facial nerve, the surgeon is making an incision which is 2 to 3 centimeters below the margin of the mandible. So this is the gland here under the mandible, the submandibular gland, and we understand the incision line should be at least 2 to 3 centimeters below the line of the mandible, so that we are not damaging the marginal mandibular branch or even the cervical branch of the facial nerve, which is going towards the platysma muscle. Supply is the platysma muscle, which is a superficial muscle, subcutaneous muscle here, also controlling the lower lip movement. If paralyzed, there might be drooping of lower lip. Anyhow, let us go into some more details. And as we mentioned, the most commonly damaged nerve for submandibular gland excision is a branch of facial nerve, marginal mandibular branch, or it could be cervical branch. But that is not the answer in our question. And why? We continue further. Now, this is again the side view of the submandibular gland, which is actually having 2 parts. A superficial part and a deep part. Both are connected in U-shaped fashion, and actually it is curving around a muscle at the floor of the oral cavity, the mylohyoid muscle. So we can mention the mylohyoid muscle, which is lying at the floor of the oral cavity. Its posterior border is separating the submandibular gland into 2 parts, a superficial part and a deep part. Now, related with mylohyoid muscle, you have 2 more muscles to remember. But first, let us show the mylohyoid muscle here with the posterior border. And then you can also note the relation of the mylohyoid muscle with the submandibular gland, having a superficial part and a deep part separated by the posterior border of the mylohyoid muscle. So this is the submandibular gland. Now, once we have mentioned about the gland and its relation with the mylohyoid muscle, you can see the gland is giving a duct
and that duct, which is around 5 centimeter long, is going to open under the tongue, one on each side, right and left side of the tongue, to give the saliva into the oral cavity. So you can mention the duct will go anteriorly under the tongue and give the salivary secretion there. Now, related to that, duct is a nerve, that is the lingual nerve, which is hooking under the submandibular duct or the Wharton's duct, and it is actually the lingual nerve which is more prone to injury when we were ligating the submandibular duct during our operation. Now, we need to talk about some muscles in relation to mylohyoid. You can see exterior to the mylohyoid muscle, there is anterior belly of digastric, which also attaches to the mandible bone. May it be the anterior belly of digastric or the mylohyoid muscle, both of them attach to the mandible bone. And still, exterior to the mylohyoid muscle, a subcutaneous muscle of the facial musculature, the platysma, is to be remembered. So there'll be one still external muscle, the platysma, which is supplied by the cervical branch of the facial nerve, as we discussed earlier as well. And then, if you are talking about the mylohyoid muscle at the floor of the oral cavity, above that is the tongue, and there'll be some tongue muscle, like one tongue muscle attaching to the mandible. Can we discuss the genial tubercle of mandible? Genioglossus muscle will be deep. So we can tell there is one muscle deeper to mylohyoid, and that will be the genioglossus muscle. So I'm just giving you some orientation of the muscles in relation to the gland hair, so that when we are taking a section from the front, you should be able to correlate them. The most superficial is platysma. Deep to that is anterior belly of digastric. Deep to that is mylohyoid. And still deeper will be genioglossus muscle. Let us take coronal section now, focusing more on the right side. And as you can notice, this is the upper teeth and the lower teeth shown on the right side. Upper teeth is actually in the upper bone, that is the maxilla bone. And the lower teeth is in the lower bone, the mandible bone. And attaching to mandible bone, we have got some muscles. Like one of that is mylohyoid muscle, the muscle at the floor of the oral cavity. Let us mark that here. And after showing the mylohyoid muscle, we can also see one muscle lying exterior to that anterior belly of digastric. And then there was one muscle which was still outside. We said platysma muscle, which is shown here. This is the platysma muscle. So basically, you can say that the anterior belly of digastric muscle is sandwiched between platysma outside and mylohyoid inside deeply. And still deeper to mylohyoid will be the tongue muscles, like one tongue muscle we have discussed. Attaching to mandible, the genioglossus muscle can be seen here. This is the genioglossus muscle, the tongue muscle. And as we know, it is to be supplied by the 12th nerve, which is not shown in the diagram, but you can mark it somewhere here. The 12th nerve, hypoglossal nerve supplying the tongue muscle. Also seen is the lingual nerve here. I told you lingual nerve, which is sensory to the anterior two-third of tongue, a branch of the mandibular nerve, is hooking under the duct of the submandibular gland. The duct which was supposed to be coming from the submandibular gland. And why we are ligating the submandibular duct, we have to be careful about the lingual nerve, because this lingual nerve can be damaged during the surgical procedure. Now, as we know, this mylohyoid muscle is dividing the submandibular gland into two parts. There's a larger superficial part and smaller deep part. So this is the larger superficial part, and separated by the posterior border of the mylohyoid muscle, you have got the deeper part, the submandibular gland, smaller portion, the deeper portion. From there only comes the submandibular duct, which is being hooked by the lingual nerve. Now, remember, mandibular nerve is having anterior division and posterior division. It is the posterior division which is giving three branches. And one of that branch is the lingual nerve. You can remember a mnemonic, Pali. And what is that? The posterior division of mandibular trigeminal nerve gives us three branches. A, the auriculotemporal nerve. L, the lingual nerve. And I, inferior posterior alveolar nerve.
So we can mark it here, the posterior division of the mandibular trigeminal, giving three branches, one going towards the auricle and temporal bone, auriculotemporal nerve, one coming to the tongue sensory area, lingual nerve, and one enters the mandible bone to supply the lower teeth, inferior alveolar nerve. This is lingual nerve, that is auriculotemporal nerve, all coming from posterior division of the mandibular trigeminal nerve. Now, among the three branches, you can see one of that lingual nerve here and the other branch, inferior alveolar nerve supplying the lower teeth, passing through the substance of the mandible here. This is the inferior alveolar nerve lying within the mandible bone. And auriculotemporal nerve is not shown here because it will be at a upper level. So what do you think? While operating on the submandibular gland, are there more chances of damaging the inferior alveolar nerve, which is running within the substance of the mandible bone, or the lingual nerve, especially when you're working on the duct of the submandibular gland? So lingual nerve is obviously the answer, though even hypoglossal nerve, which is running in the same region, the 12th cranial nerve supplying the tongue muscles like genioglossus, is also prone to injury. Let us look at some more details of 12th nerve along with the lingual nerve in another diagram, which is again a side view of the submandibular gland region. And in this side view of the submandibular gland, you can talk about the muscle, which is mylohyoid muscle. The posterior border of the mylohyoid is actually separating the superficial part of submandibular gland from the deeper part of mandibular gland. And we have mentioned that from the deeper part of submandibular gland comes the 5 cm long Wharton's duct related with the lingual nerve, hence lingual nerve prone to injury there. The same details you can mention here as well now. This is the superficial part of the submandibular gland and connected with the deeper part in a U-shaped manner in relation to the posterior border of mylohyoid muscle, to be marked now as we have shown here at the floor of the oral cavity, the mylohyoid muscle. So here is the mylohyoid muscle separating the superficial part of submandibular gland with the deep, and from the deep part of the gland comes the Wharton's duct, which you can see here. The Wharton's duct opening under the tongue, which is called as sublingual papilla, as mentioned here. You can see this is the tongue here, and the anterior two-thirds of tongue general sensations are being carried by the lingual nerve branch of the mandibular trigeminal hooking under the Wharton's duct. And this is the nerve which is prone to injury in the procedure where we were ligating the Wharton's duct. This lingual nerve is branch from the posterior division of the mandibular trigeminal nerve. So is damage during this procedure? That was our question. What about the hypoglossal nerve, which is 12th nerve and supplying the tongue muscle, is also related here to the mylohyoid muscle, actually running deep to the mylohyoid muscle and then going to reach the tongue to supply tongue muscles like genioglossus muscle. But though this nerve is also at risk of injury while operating on the submandibular gland, it is the least commonly damaged. Most commonly damaged is facial or marginal mandibular. Number two, the lingual nerve, especially while you work upon the duct. And lastly, the hypoglossal nerve, which is quite far from the duct. So let us go back to the question now. And since it is already mentioned, the nerve was injured during the process of ligating the duct. Hence, the answer for this particular question becomes the lingual nerve, choice number B. Inferior alveolar nerve, which is also a branch of mandibular trigeminal, the posterior division, is protected by the mandible bone, hence not at risk of injury. When it comes to hypoglossal nerve, it is at risk of injury. But last to be mentioned, in submandibular gland surgeries and most commonly damaged is marginal mandibular branch of facial nerve. See, the question can come, which is the most commonly damaged nerve in submandibular gland excision? Your answer is choice number D. But if you specify while working upon the duct, then you change your answer to lingual nerve, which is the case here. So choice B should remain the answer. This is a patient having an injury to the base of skull and some nerve has been compromised. So skull-based trauma leading to some difficulty of swallowing, muscles of palate and pharynx, basically, they might be compromised. The doctor was touching the marked structure and which of the following nerve is being tested. So we have to look at this sagittal section taken in a cadaver. One arrow mark is shown where the doctor is actually touching so that we can make out whether it is an assessment of 10th the vagus nerve, 9th the glossopharyngeal nerve, or the 7th facial nerve, or the 5th trigeminal nerve, because all of them are definitely related in this area. In fact, immediately we can see this diagram is showing upper lip, lower lip. This is the tongue in the oral cavity. The roof of oral cavity is the hard palate and this is soft palate. So the soft palate is being touched. Before we choose our answer, let us gather some details. Why do we touch the soft palate? Which nerve are we going to test, which might have been damaged in skull-based trauma? So let us look at another diagram for the purpose. The front view of the oral cavity, we are asking the patient to open the mouth and we are trying to touch the posterior pharyngeal wall. As we know, we call it as the gag reflex. Now understand, the gag reflex can be done not only by touching the posterior pharyngeal wall, but anything at the oropharynx level. It could be even touching the uvula, the palate. Some books will call it as the palatal reflex, but it is a component of the gag reflex only. So the broader heading is still gag reflex. Or you might be touching the posterior tongue. That is also gag reflex, or the lateral wall, the tonsillar area. So anything at the oropharyngeal isthmus and the pharynx also, posterior pharynx wall, you are basically doing gag reflex. You are trying to stimulate a nerve which supplies this region. So posterior one third of tongue, the 9th nerve. The tonsillar area, 9th nerve. The sensation of the uvula, the 9th nerve. And posterior pharynx wall, the oropharynx, 9th nerve. So it is a sensory nerve or afferent nerve. Now, where it is taking the information when you touch these regions, it'll carry it to the central nervous system. Their nucleus ambiguous will be activated. And nucleus ambiguous is having nerve number 9, 10, 11, controlling the muscles of palate, pharynx, and larynx, so that you can have speech and swallowing. Now, what is the reflex all about? The reflex is whenever you touch any of this area, there will be gag or sudden reflex movement of the muscles of palate, pharynx, and larynx. Suddenly, the gut tube will shut down and the respiratory tube also shut down. Vocal cords will shut down. The oropharynx will shut down by contraction of muscles under nucleus ambiguous. So, if the afferent or sensory nerve was the 9th nerve, then which is going to be the motor nerve? 9, 10, or 11? Actually, 9th nerve supply only one muscle, stylopharyngeus. Most of the muscles of palate, pharynx, larynx are supplied by vagus accessory complex. And recently it is mentioned by Gray's anatomy that the existence of 11th nerve, cranial part of 11th nerve, is doubtful. So it is better we choose our answer as 10th nerve. So efferent nerve is 10th nerve, the vagus nerve, which will cause contraction of these muscles and closure of the gut tube as well as respiratory tube. That is what is called as gag reflex. So basically, the gag reflex is not only checking the 9th nerve as a sensory component, but also 10th nerve as a motor component. But now you have to be careful. If you want to check the 10th nerve as such, there is other way of doing that. This is basically a method to check the 9th nerve. If you want to check the 10th nerve, let me show you how do you do that. You have to tell the patient, open the mouth and speak. You tell yourself, you demonstrate yourself and ask the patient to repeat. Say, and while doing so, what are you trying to notice? What I notice is this location, the uvula. We understand that uvula, the soft palate, is going to elevate by this maneuver because there should be contraction of the palatal muscle. First of all, you have to observe, is the uvula in the midline or is it deviated? And as you notice, it is already deviated. And deviated to which side? It is deviated to right side. So what does that suggest? When you are asking the patient to say ah, what will happen? It'll still more deviate to right side. But why? Because this patient is having left-sided 10th nerve injury, left vagus injury. So left half of the palate muscles, they cannot contract. If it is the left 10th nerve injury, the left vagus injury, the muscles cannot contract, they will sag down. But the right half of the palate is still working, they'll contract. And as they are contracting, the palate will be elevated, but only on the right side, not the left side. On the left side, it will sag down. That is why the uvula deviates to the normal side, to the right side. Right vagus is okay, and uvula deviates to right side. Left vagus is not okay. There is flaccidity, and the palate will sag down. This is how you check the vagus nerve. Though, obviously, when you are checking the gag reflex, the 9th nerve, you're also checking the 10th nerve. But for 10th nerve, more specifically, this is the clinical method. You're not supposed to touch anything, just supposed to observe. Now, let us go back to our diagram. We have to find out which all nerves are supplying in this particular area, because then we have to reach our answer. So we are basically looking from the side view. A sagittal section has been taken, and we want to know what is the nerve supply of this particular region, because again, there are more details. Next time, the examiner may go into those details. Be careful. The questions are not repeated. The topics are repeated. And next time, the depth of the question will be more. So let us do that. First, let us put the details for the landmarks before we start discussing the nerve supply in this region. And zooming a little bit here, we are looking at the upper and lower lip. This is the upper lip, and here is the lower lip. Then we can mention about the tongue. This is the tongue, where we know anterior 2/3 of tongue has different nerve supply as compared to posterior 1/3 or the root of tongue. We can also mark the hard palate here, basically the maxilla bone having the upper teeth. And if this is the hard palate, here we got the soft palate as well. The arrow mark was actually at the soft palate. And then we can mention above the palate, we have the nasal cavity. You can see this is the inferior turbinate, and also middle turbinate is evident in the lateral wall of nasal cavity. Just behind the inferior turbinate, we have the opening of Eustachian tube, which is actually nasopharynx. So this is the nasopharynx, and it is lying above the soft palate, because starting from the soft palate till the epiglottis, you'll have the oropharynx. So starting from the soft palate till the epiglottis, behind the oral cavity, behind the tongue, is the oropharynx. Whereas below the level of epiglottis downward is going to be the laryngopharynx, because it is behind the respiratory tube, the larynx. The epiglottis is a component of the larynx. In the larynx, you can see this is the laryngeal vestibule, and the nerve supply above the vocal cord is different as compared to below the vocal cord, though both are branches of the vagus nerve. So which branches we need to find out? You can also mark the bones here. The lower teeth are present in the mandible bone as shown here, and then below the mandible you have the hyoid bone as shown here. You will notice these days the examiner is putting markers on the hyoid bone, asking about the details on the Eustachian tube, on the tonsil. You see, this is oropharynx where you are having the tonsil. So we must know the details. And another question came, it was asking, what is this muscle taking origin from the mandible and the largest muscle and protruder of tongue? It is genioglossus muscle. So like that. And then we can talk about the nerve supply then. It is understood. If we are talking about the tongue anterior 2/3, the sensations are carried by 3rd branch of the 5th nerve. Mandibular nerve branch of trigeminal, the specific name will be lingual nerve. Lingual nerve branch of mandibular trigeminal is sensory to the anterior 2/3 of tongue. So till this level, it is lingual nerve branch of mandibular trigeminal. What about the posterior 1/3 of tongue? You can start from the soft palate till the epiglottis.
epiglottis and this area of the tongue will be supplied by the same nerve which is supplying the tonsillar area or the soft palate or the nasopharynx or the oropharynx. So which nerve is that? You can see posterior one third of tongue or the soft palate or the tonsils here or the oropharynx or the nasopharynx. This is the same nerve, none other than glossopharyngeal nerves. So when you are touching the oropharyngeal isthmus, may it be the soft palate or the tonsil or the base of tongue or the posterior pharynx, which nerve are you activating? That was your question. Your answer is ninth nerve. Now be careful. Even if ninth nerve is damaged and you were touching the soft palate, there might be gag reflex present. How? That is what I wanted to talk about. So it is mentioned in some books that despite a patient with glossopharyngeal nerve injury, we were checking for the gag reflex by touching soft palate. We expected it to be absent because if ninth nerve is not working, the gag reflex should be absent. But it was present. And how? Because the soft palate has additional supply from trigeminal nerve as well. So trigeminal nerve supply, which is basically for the hard palate or the nasal area, as you can notice, trigeminal nerve is supplying anterior two-thirds of tongue. The hard palate, the nasal area, is encroaching upon the soft palate also. Soft palate has double supply, though major supply glossopharyngeal, but overlapping trigeminal nerve. And that you should remember. A patient with ninth nerve injury, you expected touching the uvula, there should not be any gag reflex, but it was present because of trigeminal nerve having minor supply. Anyhow, what about the root of the tongue? You know, tongue embryologically develops from anterior two-thirds first arch. So the nerve of first arch is mandibular trigeminal. Posterior one-third of tongue, the third arch. So glossopharyngeal nerve is the nerve of third arch. The root of the tongue has contribution from the fourth arch and hence the nerve of fourth arch, superior laryngeal nerve, branch of the vagus nerve. So superior laryngeal nerve, branch of the vagus nerve, is supplying the tongue posteriormost region and also the epiglottis, because epiglottis is also developing majorly from fourth arch, and also it will continue supplying till the superior surface of vocal cord. So basically the superior laryngeal nerve, branch of the vagus nerve, supplied till the upper surface of vocal cord. What about the lower surface of vocal cord and below that? It is again a branch of vagus, but it is called recurrent laryngeal nerve. So recurrent laryngeal nerve, branch of the vagus, will supply the lower surface of the vocal cord and larynx below the vocal cord, but it is all vagus nerve. So this is the territory of the vagus nerve. Here is the territory of glossopharyngeal nerve, and this is the territory of trigeminal nerve. And by this time, we have taken care of around 10 to 15 MCQs which have come in the recent exams. So what about the question which we started with? Let's go back to that. And as I mentioned, if you are touching the soft palate, you are testing majorly the glossopharyngeal nerve, but also trigeminal nerve, because there is an overlap. And it's a trauma to the skull base, difficulty in swallowing. I will go more in favor of the gag reflex. Gag reflex is specifically for ninth nerve. Hence, the answer should be choice number B. And why not the vagus nerve? Because checking vagus nerve is, you observe the soft palate, uvula, ask the patient to say, that is how you check the vagus nerve. So obviously, gag reflex can test the vagus nerve, but this kind of maneuver is for ninth nerve, not the tenth nerve. Look at the language of the question. And what about the facial nerve? Facial nerve is for taste sensation. You will be checking the taste on the anterior two-thirds of tongue or on the palate. Then maybe. It is not general sensory here. And what about the trigeminal? Trigeminal is general sensory, of course, but not majorly. It has minor contribution. Trigeminal is more anterior, like the hard palate, anterior two-thirds of tongue, general sensation. Here it is going more in favor of glossopharyngeal nerve. Choice B should remain our answer.